thank you very much for having us here and giving us this opportunity to talk about simplifying and amplifying business strategies. The overarching theme at the NASSCOM Leadership Forum is reimagine, don't re-engineer. Well, this is my 13th year at the NASSCOM Leadership Forum, so I guess I should be doing something right, so I shouldn't either reimagine or re-engineer. Why fix it if it broke? So the gentlemen here are going to have to do all the heavy lifting. I'm pretty much going to do what I usually do when I am here. So without further ado, we're kicking off our session with Rajiv, and I believe he has an interesting presentation for us. So Rajiv, over to you.
Idea that is good for Honda or TVS is no good for me. Just as something that is good for Pepsi is no good for Coke, or something that is good for Infosys is no good for TCS, especially in recent times. So, we made a lot of scooters at one time, but our R&D was a big zero. Don't go and tell my father this, otherwise I'll lose my inheritance. But this is my opinion anyway. It takes a child sometimes to say that the emperor is naked. Which means if the solution, if the idea is right, it will go like a hot knife through butter. Even if you give a small dose, if your idea is not working, i.e. for example demonetization, don't blame execution. That means your idea itself is wrong. Today I am proud to tell you, last month when Bajaj rolled out its biggest motorcycle ever, a 400cc Dominar, it was rolled off an assembly line that was manned only by girls. So it's an all-girl assembly line that made. You know? If things are simple, then we have less and less to do. And this great man, I don't know how to pronounce his name, he has said, less and less is done until non-action is achieved. When nothing is done, nothing is left undone. Please don't take pictures of this because I don't know what this means. But you have to end with a very profound slide, so I'm ending with this.
Well, when Shereen said Rajiv will present first, I said, oh my God, that's a really hard act to follow. Rajiv, that was an amazing story, right? Dr. Devi Shetty did a project with us where his doctor sitting in Bangalore treating patients in some other part of the country, 10 rupees per prescription, and not just about checking whether you have cold or flu and giving some medicines, but really about doing ECGs, predicting are you going to have a heart attack or not, right, over time, looking at your blood sugar levels, what you should be doing. So that kind of innovation, deep innovation. If you got these four or five business fundamentals right, it doesn't matter what happens in the market or what the external factors are that you can never control. I think you'll always be ahead of the curve. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dinesh. Rishad, over to you.
So, you know, I was warned before coming to this session that, you know, Rajiv is going to talk about yoga or homeopathy and he's going to make you look dull. And that's, you know, I've got a few comments to make which I'm going to make and they're going to be sort of more mainstream, but I'm going to go with it. And then we can hopefully open it up to a different conversation as well. Look, I think the quantum of change in technology is happening faster and it's becoming more and more real. And if there's ever a time for organizations in the technology industry, in the IT services industry to be bold in India, it is now. Right? You add that change in technology with just the uncertainty that is building, the uncertainty around the outcome of the elections, both Brexit or the US elections. You add shareholder activism on top of that. You add the issue of mobility. And so you're adding a whole different level of complexity that organizations are now having to deal with on top of the very fundamental change that's happening in technology. And, you know, I'm of the strong belief that the human mind was not built to deal with this level of complexity and to be able to process it and to be able to come up with outcomes that make sense. So it really becomes the need for organizations to then design themselves in a manner in which they can deal with this and really have a system that enables that.
A lot of the problems that CEOs face is, you know, you've got these stable businesses, you've got the cash cow running, you anticipate the change, whether it's regulatory change or it's the demand environment changing, and yet being able to make that bet, pivoting fast enough, how do you ensure that you're protecting your future while not protecting your past? Rajiv, how important was that for you? Because clearly your strategy was not to protect the scooter business, but was to move away from the scooter business because that's what you were betting on in the future.
See, I'm going to quote Mark Twain because Mark Twain said, never let your schooling interfere with your education. So I tell my people, don't let your business interfere with your entrepreneurship. Because a businessman only wants to scale up something, but the entrepreneur wants to create new things, new categories, new segments, new technologies. This is very common in India, where every businessman thinks that he has a Midas touch. Just because he is making cars, he can make software. Just because he is making salt, he can make steel, and all this kind of stuff happens. So this is a sign of a developing economy, where you talk global, but actually you want to stay local and in every possible segment, because you can leverage your network here.
Rishad, you know, just to take that point forward, I think one of the problems facing the Indian IT industry at this point in time, and it's an existential issue as well, beyond what Trump and Brexit and all of that mean, is it's largely become a commoditized business. It is about price advantage, it's about low-cost arbitrage, and the low-cost arbitrage doesn't necessarily exist in the manner which it did a couple of years ago. In that situation now, how important is specialization going to be? I mean, the FMCG world is talking about premiumization. How important is it going to be for the Indian IT industry to find those niches, to find those pockets of areas of specialization, which will then allow you to get pricing premium as well?
Yeah, so, you know, I just want to comment, you know, certainly there's more pricing competitiveness, and I want to use that word carefully, you know, before we get to commoditization in the traditional run business. But I still think there's a lot of runway, you know, and opportunity around how you deliver with automation and how you play a differentiated story with automation in that space as well. But look, I think it certainly will come down to the big, bold bets that you're able to make to drive a differentiated story going forward, you know, whether it be around the whole digital story, around the whole cloud story.
Digital is a story that you're betting on, and you've done that by way of inorganic growth. You've done a bunch of acquisitions. In fact, you've been perhaps most acquisitive amongst your peers.
Correct.
So digital, via M&A, that's the big bet for you.
Well, I think M&A is an important tool, because I think M&A helps you very disruptively make perceptions that have existed in the past, right? One perception could have been about cost, quality, and scale, and how do you change that and pivot from that perception? And that's one way, certainly, to do it, I think. But it requires continued, sustained efforts, and the reality is that it will be bumpy, because as the run business sort of slows down and the change business sort of picks up, it's not going to be completely synchronized.
You talked about shareholder activism. We're seeing this not so much in India, but we're seeing this play out globally as well. When you are being assessed and evaluated quarter on quarter to the last decimal point, are you going to be able to do 22% margins, 22.4% margins, and so on and so forth? How delicate is this for you to be able to communicate to investors that this is a long-term bet, it's not going to show results maybe in the next two or three quarters, but maybe, you know, 12 or 18 months down the line?
I think, really, we give much less credit to investors than is due. I think if you are able to communicate very clearly to investors in the path and journey that you're on, they can be patient with you if they believe you, and if they see certain clear sort of markers that show progress towards that destination. So, you know, I don't worry, and I think we should worry less about sort of this challenge and this contradiction between short-term and long-term investments, because I don't think there needs to be one if you're able to have the conversation very, very clearly of what journey you're on and where you're making investments and how that will pay off over time.
Rajiv, you know, you face a lot of questions around the fact that, look, the scooter market in India is growing. Why aren't you getting back into the scooter market? This was a market that you dominated, and so on and so forth. You've stayed clear so far of the scooter market. How do you respond to people when they say that, you know, why is this a market that you're not going after?
See, I think people say say this to us because they assume that a two-wheeler is a two-wheeler. So if you're making a motorcycle, why not also make a scooter? It again comes from the same sales mentality of more is more. And I tell them, this is like saying to Sachin Tendulkar that he should play baseball, because that is about a bat and ball also. So what's the difference between baseball and cricket? You know? It doesn't work like that, because when you are wanting to be a global company, I mean, look at someone like Gillette, for example, something that all of us are familiar with because it's the best that a man can get. At least at our age, it's the best that a man can get. So, I mean, what I'm trying to say is Gillette apparently today has 60% global market share in what it does. It is synonymous with that. When you think of a burger, you don't go to Pizza Hut. When you think of pizzas, you don't go to McDonald's. So business is more about perception than reality. When a customer walks into my dealership, For me, the most important person in the company is neither the watchman nor the chairman, it's the salesman at the dealership. He has to answer to the customer, why mine? He has to be able to stand up and say, please buy mine, because the whole world is buying mine. Because the fact of the matter is, we all buy what other people buy. I mean, we don't have the guts to make, and the wisdom to make such a very reasoned and wise choice. I buy this because Rishad buys it, and he buys it because Shereen buys it. So if... Well, in a manner of speaking only. So, I am saying that in life we should climb only one mountain at a time. If there comes a time when Bajaj has 20, 30, we have only 10% global motorcycle market share. Should I try to move in the motorcycle segment, which is 35 million vehicles worldwide, from 10% to 15, 20, 25, 30, where I have tailwinds? Or should I try and address the scooter segment where we are zero and try and build it up from there and build a presence? I mean, for me, it's a no-brainer. But the problem is, again, these management concepts like reimagine and re-engineer. Because I'm told you should reimagine this. So my answer is this, that, I'm always told by media people, by analysts, that this is called de-risking. That scooter bhi hoga, motorcycle bhi hoga, toh ye nahi chalega, toh ye chalega. This is not de-risking. This is gambling. This is playing darts. This is distraction. And this is fragmentation of resources. I mean, at the end of the day, you must be like Arjun and you must believe you can see the eye of the bird and you must go for it. And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. At least you gave it the best shot. So that's what I...